2000 and beyond. Not yet. Dr. McKinnon is a science team member on NASA's New Horizon missions to Pluto and the Kuiper Belt, where he serves as deputy leader for the geology and geophysics imaging team. He is also a science team member for the European Space Agency's upcoming Jupiter Icy Moons Explorer mission. There's some good questions there to be asked, I'm sure, at the end, including that super big rocket that NASA is building. Dr. McKinnon is a past chair of the Division for Planetary Sciences of the American Astronomical Society, past president of the Planetary Sciences section of the American Geophysical Union. He is a fellow of the Geological Science Society of America and the American Association for the Advancement of Science. And in 2014, he received the G.K. Gilbert Award from the Planetary Geology Division of the GSA for outstanding contributions to the solution of fundamental problems in planetary geology. And he has an asteroid named after him. Asteroid 9526, Bill McKinnon. So, please not get stuck. Dr. McKinnon holds a Bachelor of Science degree from MIT, a Master of Science and PhD in Planetary Science and Geophysics from Caltech. So, on behalf of the SGS and our supportive partners at the U of R, I'd like to ask all of you in joining with me in welcoming Dr. McKinnon to speak to us today.
It has been over 3,000 days since we left Earth. We're now almost 3 billion miles away from home. Out here, where the sun is distant and faint, is a place no one has ever seen before. Pluto and its system of moons, the farthest worlds ever world. From Mercury to Neptune, revealed its own startling complexity, character, and unimagined beauty. As we now approach the Pluto system, reaching farther again, this year we are about to complete the historic first era of planetary exploration.
Sensational discovery. Ninth planet discovered at the edge of the solar system. The first star in 84 years. As we're talking about Neptune 84 years earlier. So this is a search that began at telescopes based on ideas that there might be something beyond the planet Neptune. And this guy, Clyde Tombaugh, from the American state of Kansas, was hired to design and search for this planet. And he built a machine where he could blink photographic plates back and forth. Remember, there's no computers back then. And he was able to find this thing that the late Percival Lowell, who had founded the observatory in Arizona, had predicted. Now, so when they found this thing, was this little dot that had moved. Nevertheless, the astronomers hailed the finding, right, it says right there, and the sphere, possibly larger than Jupiter, meets prediction. I hope most of you realize that Pluto is not as big as Well, you know, we get to be improved now as time goes on. So, but for a long, long time, Pluto remained simply a mysterious dot on a photographic plate. Not hardly anything was known. It wasn't clear what its place in the picture of the solar system was. Now, when I was a boy, I loved all the planets, but I especially loved the fact that we were finally going to see things. Here's another New York Times front page. This is somewhat later, July 16, 1965. So I was a young lad then, and I remember this is the first picture ever taken close up of the surface of Mars, and you can hardly see anything. But it's the beginning. It's the beginning of that exploration of all these distant worlds. And so what we did, what the human race did, last summer, was finally reach that remote outpost that was discovered in 1930. And this is that moment. This is the moment when the first close-up picture came up on the screen on July 14th. That's the 5-minute in Maryland, between Washington and Baltimore, which is where I was. And it was completely amazing for us. And this is what we saw. This is what Percival Lowell predicted, and this is what Clyde Tombaugh discovered. A small planet, to be sure, but still a planet nonetheless. This is a natural color photograph, I believe. You've probably seen this in newspapers or on TV or on the internet. And I'll say more about it later. But I don't want to make it sound like it's easy, because it wasn't, okay? Just like the video said, we journeyed through all the planets, and in the US, the United States Postal Service put out a series of stamps after various machines had visited all of the classical planets out to Neptune. But the last stamp there, the one in the lower right, that's Pluto, and what it says, it's not being explored. And there wasn't any real push to explore it on the part of you of the American Space Agency, NASA. But those of us who were younger really wanted to keep going. We wanted to find out what the next thing was. We wanted to compare, especially after we saw the amazing moons of Neptune, we wanted to compare that special moon in Neptune, Triton, what we thought Pluto was. But it wasn't easy. Here are six missions, all designed or possibly going to Pluto, but only one of them ever made it. This one here on the left is actually a real machine. It's called Voyager 1. And it was sent to Saturn, and it could have gone to Pluto, but they decided to, and wisely so, to alter its trajectory so that it passed by Saturn's big moon Titan. But all of these others simply didn't fly at all. They were proposed and canceled. Some were very big, and we'll really cancel. But nevertheless, we started working again and again. Basically, the younger people in the U.S. planetary science community forming committees, making arguments that this, in fact, would be a scientifically justifiable thing to do. So I've been working at this. A bunch of us have been working at this for actually 25 years. This is the culmination of a lifelong ambition. You may not recognize this, but that's in me 25 years ago. But this is the principal investigator, Alan Stern, or who would become the principal investigator in New Horizons. And he looks like he just got out of high school. Part of our argument was that it actually is a kind of, you know, we didn't know much about it, but the things that it could figure out were fascinating. Astronomers from the Earth watched a star go behind Pluto in 1988, and they saw that the light didn't wink out and wink on again, but in fact dimmed slowly and then went to zero, and then slowly came back. So we knew Pluto had an atmosphere. This body so far from the sun had an atmosphere, and that atmosphere was made of the same gas that dominates our own. We then discovered that Pluto had a giant moon, kind of like Earth's moon compared to Earth, but even bigger in comparison. And people began to do computer models, or theoretical models, but computer models of how Pluto could have acquired its moon. Well, this is a simulation, a supercomputer simulation of a collision of two bodies in distant space long ago. Gravity causes everything to wrap and spread. All the little blue bits are icy bits. The red stuff is rocky bits, because that's what stuff is made of out there, rock and ice. And eventually you get something like